Good evening. I hope you can hear me. Does it work? It works. Praise the Lord. I did not get to sleep, so if I fall asleep, wake me up when I am done. I'm very pleased to be with you, and thank you so much for the kind introduction and for inviting me here. It is a privilege for me. And I believe that the Holy Spirit is here. And I believe that God has plans greater than we have prayers. I remember, I used to do quite a lot of bad stuff. Not bad, but, you know, pranks. I would go into the attic of the church, and they had a I don't know how you call it in English, those things that you heat the room with, like some elements, and radiator, or however you call it. And in the summer, there was no hot water in those radiators. And in the attic, they had a pipe and a container that if it was too much water or air, it would go there. So I would go in the attic of the church and open the faucet and put my ear to the pipe and listen what the church board would talk in the boardroom at the pipe. And then I would tell my dad at home, I know exactly what is going on in the church. And my dad would ask the board, who is talking at home? They didn't know that I was listening in the attic. When my dad and my mom would talk in the house, I would get down on the floor, open the door slowly in the night, and get by their bed, patiently and slowly, and I could hear them talking. And I will never forget, when my dad would talk to the board, he would say again and again, you need to give it up, folks. You need to surrender. Stop arguing for nothing. These things are going to burn. You need to be a blessing for the community. Whatever sermons we preach will never change anybody unless you are the light of the community. God called you to be a blessing. That's the best evangelism. And I was like so proud of my dad telling the board that they should get their act together and become a blessing for people. But then I heard my dad talking to my mom in the night when they thought I was asleep. And my mom would say, "Did you see what he did today?" And my dad said, "Yeah, I know. When I was like him, I did even worse." And my mom said, "You should not tell him that." And my dad said, "Well, if I tell him what I did, he knows that I'm real and he is real. But then I tell him how God changed me, and he will know that God is going to change him." And my mom said, "You need to discipline him." And my dad would say, "Honey, he doesn't know God, but he knows me. I want to be God for him. I want to love him with so much grace that he would just rejoice coming to me regardless. And I want him to know that I am nothing compared to God. And if God is only like me, he would go to God joyfully." To represent God to your family. You follow me? And then I remember my dad saying to my mom, he would come home from work, and in the time when salary was 1,600 a month average, he would bring home 25,000, 30,000 a month. He was very well to do. And my mom would say, "Okay, 25,000, 10% is 2,500. And my father said, "Yeah, you can keep 2,500. Give the rest to the church." And my mom said, "Honey, 10% is tight." And my father said, "No, honey, that's the minimum you can give. You cannot give less than that." And my father said, "Why would I spend my money for things that burn? Jesus is coming soon. Don't you want to invest in heaven?" And my father said, "Take them tomorrow before you spend it. Give it all to the church." And my mom, "Can we keep 10,000? And my father said, you cannot keep more than 2,000. "Don't worry, honey. Tomorrow I'm going to bring more." And he would take sometimes all of it and go to the church and say, "Get Bibles, do evangelism, take it all, build churches, take it all. I'm going to bring more next month." We got to be a blessing. We got to be a blessing. And I remember I cannot help, I eat 10 times a day and I never gain a pound. I know it's not fair, but who says life is fair? I eat and 2 hours later I'm hungry again. It just burns right away. It just, I need to eat. In fact, every time I see food, I feel it in my stomach and I cannot help. I just stop and eat again. So we had an apartment that was like a train. You would go from bathroom and then it was my bedroom, and my sister's bedroom, and then my bedroom, and then our parents' bedroom, and then the living room, and then the kitchen. It was like a train. So to go from my bedroom to the kitchen, you would go through everybody's room. And so I eat. So at 10 p.m., I would go and eat. 12 midnight, everybody was asleep. Guess what I did? I would go and eat. Around 2, 3 a.m., I woke up because I was hungry, so I would go and eat. Every time I would pass through my parents' bedroom, guess what my father was doing? He was not snoring. He was praying. And one time I asked him, "Why do you pray so long? When do you sleep?" And he said, "Between prayers." And then I said, "Who do you pray for?" And he said, "For you." I said, "I don't need so much prayer." "I told you you do." I said, "How do you know?" "Well, you just said that you don't need prayer. That tells me that you do." I said, "Dad, I go to church." He said, "Well, you see, that's the reason I pray for you. Do you think because you go to church you don't need prayer? Don't you see how many bad things happen even in God's presence? People who go to church, you know why they do that? Because they don't spend time in prayer, son." You follow? And so he kept praying. And he would talk to my mom and say, make sure that you prepare the best food for Friday night. They should love to think about Sabbath. Prepare cookies, prepare the best foods. Friday night, we would get together and we would eat the best food. And my father, would, after we eat, would tell stories from the Bible and then stories from his life. How police would come and tell him to stop bringing Bibles and stop building churches and so on and so forth. He would tell a story. And after he was done with the stories, he would put all of us sit around and then he would pray over my mom and bless her and praise the Lord for her. And then he would pray over my sisters and bless them and praise the Lord for them. And then he would pray over me and bless me and praise the Lord for me. And then he would pray for the whole family. And then he would say, Lord, would you bring heaven in this house so we experience it even now? Would you bring heaven in this house? And then my father would come close to me and take me like that by cheeks and look straight eye to eye and say, son, my father, talking about my grandfather, my father was a man of prayer and he blessed me and passed the blessing unto me. I pray and I am passing the blessing to you. You make sure that you pass the blessing to your children into 1,000 generations. And I said, Dad, what if I don't pray? Well, son, you lose the blessing for 4 generations, but only for 4. Because God is so gracious, he's going to do something and start the prayer again. Because I am praying for 1,000 generations. Wasn't that something? And he told me that every Friday night. It got here, and I cannot forget it. Just got there, you know? What if we all did that for our children? Can you imagine how life would change? When we had an earthquake in 1977, it was 7.3, I believe, on Richter scale for 1 minute and 15 seconds. First did like that, and then like that for almost a minute, and then like that again. Many buildings collapsed. As far as I remember, the news, the TV said that 240,000 people got killed. I saw buildings, tall buildings, that half was missing. It was just rubble. And I saw parts of body, a leg or only one hand. When the earthquake started, in our apartment building, we lived at the 4th floor. And when the earthquake started to hit us from wall to wall, my mom said, we are going to die. And my father said, and do you see Jesus? And then my father said to my sister, go to the piano. And she said, okay. And the piano was moving. And I said, play Rock of Ages. And she said, are you sure? I said, just do it. And she started to play and he started to sing. Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide. You remember the song? And neighbors were running down the stairs. There were 14 apartments on each stairway. They were running down the stairs. Elevators didn't work. And they would run outside the building as far as possible so if the building collapses, it would not kill them. My father didn't. He said, honey, if Jesus wants us to live, he's going to put angels hold the building. Let's sing. Now, this is the strange part. The other stairways, they all went down. On our stairway, they all came to our door and they started to knock. Mr. Goya, open the door. He opened the door. What? Can we come in? He said, why? They said, we know that Jesus is here. We know that the angels, in a communist country where people don't believe in God, we know that heaven is here. Let us in. It's the single safe place in the whole city. 270,000 people city. And they all attack. It's the single safe place. Can we come in? And he said, oh, you want to taste heaven? Come in. And then he said, sit down. And the building was moving. And he said, now you follow me. And he said, Rock of Ages, cleft for me. And the earthquake stopped. And he said, now you can go back home. You need to get heaven in your homes too, folks. Isn't that something? What if we all did that? That would be evangelism, wouldn't it? I remember, and this is the last story, and then we start the sermon. When our son lost his brain, and he turned stupid somehow, and he said, during the week, I go to school, and then I go to work. I never have time for fun. Sunday, I do a bunch of homework for the whole week. The single day that I have off is Saturday. I'm not going to go to church. I go on the lake. And they said, Gabe, you need to go to church. Hey, let me make my decision. You decide for you, I decide for me. When I am your age, I said, what does it mean, my age? He said, when I am your age, I go to church. Right now, I need to have fun. He started to drink. He stopped going to church. He started to go with girls. And then he started to speed. He had 32 speeding tickets in short time, about 11 accidents in 1 year. My insurance, well, sky high. So I cut him off my insurance. My wife, you cannot do that. He will get upset with us and never talk to us. I said, good for him. I cut him from the insurance. And then he would call her because he knew that mother's love, it's a little different sometime. Mom, I need money. I didn't eat today. And she would send him money. I said, Dana, stop sending him money. And Dana would say, Gabe, you need to talk to your dad. He would call me, I need money. I said, yep, go to work. Stop drinking. I hate you. I love you too. I will never come to see you again. I can hardly wait to see you again. He would say, leave me alone. I said, I will pray for you. I don't want you to pray for me. You cannot tell me what to pray for. In fact, I tell you, the more you say, the more I am going to pray. So my wife and I prayed every morning from 5 to 7 for him for 2 years. And my wife fasted every Wednesday. I don't fast. I need to eat. But she did every Wednesday. And so when we started to pray from 5 to 7 and she started to fast, he started to experience kind of a lot of big challenges. One time he fell asleep driving 95 miles per hour. And when he woke up, he was hitting the concrete foot of a bridge. So he pulled the steering wheel, the car went spinning and jumped off the road 27 feet free fall into a valley, into a swamp that was mud, water, and weeds and bushes. And the car sunk into the mud. An 18-wheeler that was far behind saw him spinning and then disappearing. Called the police. They came and the guy, the driver said, somewhere there, but I don't know because he was too far. They looked 2 miles back and forth, and they could not see any car because the car was under the mud. And there he tried to open the door. It didn't. He tried to start the car. It didn't work. Eventually he said, Lord, I'm sorry. If I repent, would you save me? And after he prayed, he turned the key again and the lights came on. So he rolled down the window and, you know, got out through the window and got up the road and he waved and they came with a crane and got the car out. He was late, 8 hours late. We knew that something happened because he was supposed to get home 8 hours earlier. So he said, Daddy, I had an accident. I know, I've been praying for you. That's the reason I keep having accidents, because you keep praying. Stop praying. I said, son, I pray until you turn around, so stop telling me what to do. Anyway, accident after accident after accident. I'm going to go to the end of the story so we could start the sermon. One Sabbath, instead of going to church, he and his stupid friends took the four-wheelers and they went in Collegedale up the mountain. But the mountain was so steep that the four-wheelers would not go. But he was smarter than the smart ones. So he said, I can go. So he went backwards, got speed. When he went up the mountain, the four-wheeler tipped over. and cut his head between the four-wheeler and the rock and took the right side of his head. And there was helmet shattered all over, and there were pieces of bone shattered all over, and there were pieces, splinters of bone coming through the eye, and there was naked brain. It was a mess. They took him to hospital. He was in coma. And they called us, Mr. Goya, don't panic, but he had an accident and he's in coma. Don't panic? Kids. They have a room, but there is no furniture inside. So the doctor called us, and the doctor says, I'm sorry, but I think he has only about 4 hours to live. When you get a phone call that your kid has 4 more hours, I ask you, how do you pray? Father in heaven, thank you for being with me last night. Would you be with Gabe today and save him? Amen. That's the way you pray? I don't think so. That's the prayers we pray for our children, for our families, for our spouses. Da-da-da-da-da. Amen. That's routine. That's poetry. If you don't mean it, why would you expect God to mean it? Repetition of set customary forms where the heart feels no need are an abomination. That's a quote from the spirit of prophecy. God wants us. Prayer is the opening of the heart to God as to a friend. God wants us to labor in prayer. You got 2 minutes. So my wife and I got in the car, called Elder Corkum, who was the conference president in that time in Wisconsin. Do I speak too fast? No. If I do, pray for the gift of tongues. Okay. So I called Elder Corkum. I said, I got to go. I got in the car. 12-hour trip. We did it in 9 hours and 15 minutes. If they would have caught me, they would have taken my pilot license because we are flying. 5 hours of laboring prayer. Lord, please save his life. And God did not answer. And we kept laboring and praying and humbling ourselves and pleading and asking for a miracle. And God would not answer. And I started to talk to the Lord. I said, tell me why. And God said, you both made a God from this child. Made him a God. And you need to give him up. Whatever you give up, that's what you get. And whatever you get, that's what you lose. Because who saves his life is going to lose it. Only who is willing to lose his life is going to save it. Whatever you keep is what you lose. Whatever you sacrifice for the Lord is what you finally get. You follow me? That's the economy of heaven. The bread that you throw is the bread that you get. You follow me? So God impressed me that we need to give him up. That's not an easy prayer. Just try it. And you believe me. So I said, Lord, I really had a hard time to say the words. We are willing to sacrifice him, to give him up. Like Abraham. When Abraham was willing to sacrifice him, finally he got him. You follow me? But we could not see it in that time. So I said, Lord, we are willing to lose our son. We don't want anything between us and you. Whatever comes between you and God, could be your job, your house, whatever, you don't have time for God because that's your God. Oh, you may fool yourself that you love God more than anything. That's baloney. Whatever comes first, that's your God. So I said, Lord, we are willing to lose him, but I am not willing to lose his salvation. So yes, take his life, but save him. And when I prayed that prayer, Dana started to cry and said, that's too much. I said, honey, do you have another option? I said, nope. Hey, this life is short anyway. Let's focus on eternity. Because God says, seek first what? So let's do that, not just talk about it. So I said, Lord, give him salvation, but I am not going to give up on that one. I give up the first, but not the second. So I said, you better kill me, but I am not going to negotiate on the second one. And the Lord said, are you crazy? Do you think that I want him to be saved? Why did I give Jesus to begin with? I want him saved more than you want him saved. So yes, I did answer that prayer. He will be saved. And when God said that, for some reason, I instantly started to sing. It just came. And I started to sing a song that in Romanian it says, I am the son of the king, of the king, of the king. I am the son of the king. And it says, and I have joy when I walk. And I have joy when I do things. And I have joy. And I said, honey, I got peace. And she says, how do you know that God answers? I just know. Because I got peace. And I just don't need to pray asking. Now I need to pray praising. And the leftover 4 hours and 15 minutes, we kept praising. While we were praising, the doctor from Erlanger or whatever is the name in Chattanooga calls and says, Mr. Goya, don't ask me to explain it. I don't know how to explain it. We did 2 CAT scans. There is no bone, but there is no brain damage. The brain was not touched. He will live. And then 2 hours later, the doctor calls and says, Mr. Goya, there are splinters of bone coming through the eye, but the optical nerve was never touched. He has 20/20 vision. He is not blind. And every time I would say, yep, praise the Lord. And my wife, honey, keep the steering wheel straight. We want to get there. Don't worry, honey. Another victory. And as we were talking, the doctor said, we cannot wait for you anymore. We need to get him in the surgery. I said, go ahead. God is there with you because I am praying. Okay. We got there. They did 5 plastic surgeries to match the left side from titanium to do the right side that would match the left side. And they made him from titanium and covered him. And eventually, he was all bandages, only this eye out. He came out of surgery, and I am there, and his mom is there. And he wakes up, and he says, am I dead? I said, shame on you. You are Adventists. Adventists don't believe that dead people talk. If you are dead, you know nothing. The fact that we talk, it means that you are alive. He says, yeah, you are right. And then he says, do I have brain damage? I said, impossible, because you don't have a brain. What was wrong with you to go up the mountain? And he says, don't make me laugh. It hurts. And then he says, am I going to be ugly? I said, son, you're never good looking like me to begin with. And I said, no, son, they made you better than before. And I said, you are better because your heart is better, because now you have a story to tell. And he started to cry. When I said, you have a story to tell, he started to cry. He said, I want to change, but I have no power. Every time I made a decision to change, I never managed. I always fail. And I said, aren't you stupid? Who told you that you have the power to overcome Satan? Who do you think you are? I said, who told you that you need to overcome Satan? Don't you learn, son, that Jesus got victory at the cross, and what you need Jesus? Stop focusing on sin and Satan. From now on, you need to focus on Jesus. And he said, I'm trying to get it. How do you do that? I said, well, my dad told me that if you invite Jesus in your heart, Satan and Jesus cannot share the same apartment. When Jesus comes in, Satan runs out. And he doesn't even go through the door. He jumps out the window. And so I said, every morning, every 10 o'clock, every noon, every 2 p.m., every 5 p.m., every evening, 10 times a day, you say, Jesus, I want you back in. And you are safe when you do that. And we pray together, and he never turned around. He is just better than anybody can ask. So, let's start our subject. What if we prayed this type of prayers for our children? And if you didn't, it's never too late. You better start today. The scripture reading said, God forbid that I sin by not praying for you. It is a sin not to pray for them. Let's go into the subject. I need a PowerPoint, please. Okay, good. So, the Bible story says that, you see, Elkanah had a wife, and her name was Hannah. And she could not get pregnant. And she probably started to eat a lot of tofu and a lot of broccoli, hoping that if she eats healthy, she would get pregnant. And it didn't happen. So what she did, she prayed a lot and had anointing, and she still didn't get pregnant. But then she prayed and had faith, and she still didn't get pregnant. And then she went to the doctors, and she didn't get pregnant. And then she went to the best doctor in Cincinnati, that specialist that he makes miracles. And she went to that doctor, and she didn't get pregnant. And then she turned 60, and then she turned 70, and then she turned 150. I'm exaggerating. And she didn't get pregnant. And after many years, according to the Hebrew grammar, it says that she kept praying for many years, if you do translation from Hebrew. She didn't pray for a month or two. She prayed for a long time. Did it ever happen to you that you pray for a long time and you don't seem to get an answer? And she didn't get an answer. What would happen to your faith when you keep praying and nothing happens? Well, she kept praying and praying and praying and praying and no results. In that time, as today happens too, instead of the church influencing the world, it's the other way around. The world is influencing the church. And there was no difference in that time between the Adventists and the rest of the Canaanites. They were just the same. So in that time, they, instead of following God, they said, give us a king like the nations. And then they said, hey, why don't we take many wives like the nations? God never created Adam and Eve's. God created Adam and Eve, singular. But it was a belief that if you had children, you are blessed. And if you didn't have children, you are cursed. So in order to be blessed, they would marry 2, 3, 4, 5 wives, and they thought they got a blessing. Well, I tell you, they got a curse. Because 5 wives, imagine. So, I'm not talking about the qualities. I'm talking about the number. Okay, so, what happened when he married Penina, a second wife, in order to get children? Penina started to give Hannah hard time. Mock her, ridicule her, make fun of her. Basically made her life miserable. That house was not a house anymore. It was hell. You remember the Bible verse? And the Bible says that, if you go there, that she was in bitterness of soul, and she prayed to the Lord, and she wept in anguish, and she continued praying. Well, I'm going to move quick. She continued, the word continued is rabach. That means that she did not pray a quick prayer. Lord, please be with me today, la 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 la, amen. That means abundant, excessive, numerous prayers. She was a woman of prayer. That's what God is calling us to be, and the church to be, a house of prayer. Praying people, praying people, praying people. Okay. And as she prayed, and she prayed, and she prayed, and she prayed, nothing happened. But at a certain point in her life, she got it. She changed her prayer. She didn't say, give me a child, or deliver me from this Penina that she is so evil. She stopped praying that prayer. What she prayed, she basically gave up the request. I don't know if you follow me. Usually, whatever you ask is what you don't get. And whenever you give it up, then God says, now I can give it to you. Because you need to be able to surrender it in order for the Lord to give it to you. So when she finally was able to say, if you give me a child, I will give him to you. That means I give him up. It's yours. Then God said, now I can give you a child. Only what we surrender is what we get. Remember that. Remember that. When you pray for a blessing and you don't get one, remember that. God doesn't give you blessings for you. He wants you to surrender. Anyway, let's move on. When she said, if you give me a child, I'll give him to the Lord, then it happened. So those who lived close, they would go to the sanctuary 3 times a year. Those who lived far, they would go 1 time a year. Elkanah, Hannah, and Penina, and her children, Penina's children, they went to the sanctuary from Rabbah. There was no sanctuary. It was the tabernacle. It was before Solomon built the sanctuary because it was in 180, way before. Okay, so they went to the tent. While they were eating, she didn't eat. She went and she prayed. And she says, Lord, please, would you please give me a kid? If you give me a kid, I'm going to sacrifice him, give him to the Lord. And while she's praying, the pastor comes and says, what's wrong with you? Stop drinking. Get sober. Now, if you are in terrible pain, and you have been praying for years and years for something, and you go to the church, and you kneel down there, and you pray, and the pastor comes to you and says, hey, are you drunk? What is wrong with you? Don't you love that pastor? Oh, you feel like hugging him. Oh, you follow me? What did she do when the pastor rebuked her? What did she do? Eh? You remember? You see it on the screen? Yes, you do. Do not consider that I am a wicked woman, because I am just praying. And that really not such a good priest says, okay, go in peace. May the Lord answer your prayer. What a relief. You go to church after 20 years of praying for a baby, and Jimmy, the neighbor, comes to you and says, go in peace. How is that supposed to give you comfort? You have been praying already for 20 years. You have been going to the doctors. But you know what? What did she do when he said, go in peace? What did she do next? What did she do? Huh? She jumped up. She started to eat. And she was no longer sad. And she started to rejoice. And she, I mean, if you read in the Bible, let me tell you something here. How did she know that God was talking? Because that was not was not the best pastor. How did she know? Let me tell you how. Listen carefully. She was a woman of prayer. People who pray are people who recognize God's voice. And God may talk to a child, or God may talk to a donkey. Doesn't really matter. Or God may talk to a neighbor, or God may just talk, I don't know. But people who pray a lot, they are able to distinguish God's voice from a thousand voices. And people who tell me, how do you recognize God's voice? I pray. Oh, we pray too. No, you don't. Because prayer is not an event that you pray in the spare of a moment when you go through a crisis. Prayer is not a second that you pray 1 minute in the morning and amen. Prayer should be a lifestyle, 24/7. Pray without ceasing. My wife and I put my eyes on her when she was 3 years old, and I kept my eyes on her, and when she was 18 and I was 22, we got married, and we have 31 years of marriage. We had 31 years in January, and I love her even more than before. And we talk about 10,000 times a day. And I cannot even function without her. I am handicapped. I don't even know how to get dressed, how to choose the tie or whatever without her. And so my wife knows that I need to eat. And she calls me every 2 hours. Honey, you better stop and get a sub. Because if not, you faint. You know that you need to eat. I said, I am busy. Stop and get a sub. Okay. She calls me 5 minutes later. Did you eat? Not yet. I want you to stop right now. I'm not going to leave you alone before you stop. Okay. 5 minutes later. Did you buy? I did. 2 hours later. Honey, I want you again to go and buy a sub. Okay. Now, when I go home, before I get home, last 3 miles, I drive between mountains and I lose signal. I lose signal. And my phone goes off. Psst, and I answer. And I hear, honey, sub. How do I know that it's her? We have been talking all our life. I know the voice. I know the message. I know her. How would people expect to know God if they talk to him only in a need? You need to talk to him every 5 seconds. Every 2 hours. You need to keep talking to him when you drive, when you wake up, when you go to sleep. You need to keep talking to him in order to recognize his voice, because relationships are based on quality time spent together. There is no relationship without time. It just doesn't exist. Oh Lord, would you help me? No wonder Jesus says, I don't know you. You follow me? She was a woman of prayer. When that guy spoke, go in peace. She instantly jumps and she says, I am pregnant. And he says, "Ooh, slow down. What happened to you, woman?" He didn't get it. He didn't even know maybe that the Lord used him. So she goes back and she starts eating. And her husband, wow. You usually cry and pray when we eat. And she is happy, no longer sad. And he says, what happened? And she says, I am pregnant. You didn't get your period last month? Oh, yes, I did. You feel something moving in your tummy? Oh, no. So how do you know? God talked to me. How do you know? Oh, I know his voice. People who pray are people who know the Lord. Now listen carefully to what is next. People who know the Lord trust the Lord. I don't know if you heard what I said. If you don't pray, you don't know him. If you don't know him, how could you trust a stranger? We pray and then we doubt. What if he doesn't answer? If you knew your God, you would not doubt him ever. Because we have a God like nothing else and nobody else in the universe ever. And if we would just open our eyes for a second and see what he does for us, we would be ashamed that we don't trust him. But people who pray know him, and people who know him trust him. Therefore, when Eli said, go in peace, she knew. She didn't say, how am I going to get pregnant? She could not care less. If God said, you'll be pregnant, she said, yep. You follow me? Don't expect faith without relationship. They just don't go the other way around. They only go this way. Now listen, she didn't just pray, know the Lord, trust the Lord. She had joy. People who pray have peace. A peace that nobody can give. A peace that nobody can take. Whatever they go through, whatever they go through. When I see Seventh-day Adventists like that, I say, what happened to you? Where is God? Oh, I prayed. I said, I don't know what he has done to you, but that's not my God. I have a different God. Look what he has done to me. I'm smiling and whistling, singing all the time. When I drive, when I go to camp meeting, when I put tents, I don't like tents. In fact, I hate tents because they have spiders and dust. But you know what? I whistle and sing all the time. You go and ask anybody among pastors. Wherever you hear whistling, I'm there. Because when God is with you, you could be in prison, you could be on the top of the mountain, and you could be in the valley. If you are not alone, you could be in the fiery furnace. If you are not alone, guess what? You have peace. You know, when we are so sad, that says a lot about what type of God we have. And when we are so happy and have peace, that says a lot about what type of God we have. Better than sermons. That makes religion attractive, not programs. I'm not saying that we should not have programs. I'm just saying that we got to get our priorities straight. You follow me? So, she was a woman of prayer, and she knew the Lord. And because she knew the Lord, she had faith. And because she had faith, she had peace. Okay? Let's move on. Prayer is not an event, but a process. Therefore, when you start praying, God starts working, but you don't see the answer. Therefore, you need to know him in order to trust him. Because if you don't trust him, he cannot work. Without faith, it's impossible to please the Lord. Anyway, let's move on. Let's move on. Prayer and faith always go together. They rose early in the morning and they left and they went home to Ramah. And it came to pass that in the process of time, and if you go to Hebrew, it means in a long time. It was not tomorrow. Another 2, 3, 5 years. It's not that she got pregnant. But meanwhile, she was rejoicing. God told her that she will be pregnant and she could not care less. It's like my wife and I. My wife loves, if you know the perfume that is called Estee Lauder. And they have a perfume that is called Dazzling. On silver and gold. She loves Dazzling on gold. And she says to me last year, honey, I finished my last bottle. And that's an expensive perfume. It's not $20. It's an expensive one. but I love her more than money. So she said, it's empty. And I said, honey, you want me to buy one? No, I would have. I went to Macy's. I went to JCPenney. It's discontinued. I said, yeah, they always discontinue the good stuff for some reason. And she said, I looked everywhere. I could not find one. And I like this one. And I said, honey, I'll get you one on your birthday. And it was just about 2 weeks away. And she says, but it's discontinued. It doesn't exist. I asked them. They checked everywhere. They called other malls around. I said, honey, I will get you one. You don't need to worry how. And she knows me. If I give my word, she can go to sleep. If I promise an elephant, she will get an elephant. Doesn't matter. If I promise, I would rather die than not to keep my word. So she said, okay, I got a dazzling. I said, on your birthday. I checked online and checked and checked and checked, and I found it. And I called them, and I said, I want you to send it on August 20th. And they said, okay. I said, not okay. Listen carefully. I want it on August 20th. They said, okay. I said, no, you don't listen. If it doesn't come on August 20th, I'll make you pay 10 times the price. I tell you, you'll be sorry. You are going to give me 2 dazzlings and $100 back and another gift card, and I will make you be sorry. I want you to verify and make sure that August 20, I have it in the mail. I am not joking. Don't try me. We heard it, Mr. Goya. I said, okay. August 20, guess what happened? It didn't come. Oh, my stomach was going like that. I called them. I said, I cannot believe what you did. I told you I'm not joking. They said, is there? It arrived 2:30. We have it here. It was delivered. I said, no, 2:30. I was by the mailbox. And they came and they didn't deliver. They said, no, it was delivered. I said, tell me where. 1575 Harpy Road, Stanford. You stinkers, it's Frankfurt. It's not Stanford. You delivered to a wrong city. Oh, I said, you are going to send me 2, not 1, and you are going to pay me back what I paid, and you are going to send me another gift card of $100. I will make you pay for it, and you should come tomorrow in the mail. 2, not 1. Oh, we cannot do that. Give me the manager. Oh, I got 2 of them next day, and the $100 gift, believe me. I tell you the truth. So I go to Dana, and I put my head in the kind of in the ground. Honey, this is what happened. Before I finish the story, it didn't come today. She takes me like that. She says, psst, keep quiet, come here. And she kissed me long, and she said, we have been together 31 years. I know you enough. You don't need to explain. I get you tomorrow, don't I? I said, 2, not 1. I make them pay for it. I could tell that before you told me the story. And instantly, she kissed me, she hugged me, and she started to jump. I'm going to get 2. I'm happy it didn't come today. Now, she didn't get 2. She did get 2 tomorrow. But that day, she still did not have them in hand. How did she know that she'll get 2 tomorrow? She knew me, and that was enough. You follow me? Do you get the point? Do you get the point? She didn't get pregnant right away. In the process of time, it took another 2, 3, 4 years, I don't know. But she knew the Lord. If the Lord said, you'll be pregnant, she knew God is working on it. That's what type of faith people who pray have. I don't know if you follow my bad English. If you don't have that faith, it means that you need to get busy praying, brother and sister. You follow me? So, let's move on and finish. So, people who pray know the Lord. People who know the Lord have faith. People who have faith have peace. She got pregnant, and then they went to the sanctuary. She stayed home to win the child. How many years? 6. Okay, when the baby was 6 years old, she took him to the temple and dedicated him to the Lord and left him there. Is it okay? No. We have two boys, Gabriel and Ovi. When we drove Gabriel from Wisconsin to Tennessee, to Collegedale, Gabriel was not 6 years old. He was 14. Oh, she cried all the way. I said, honey, he's alive.
I lost my baby.
You have Facebook. You have cell phone.
Not the same. I lose my baby.
He is alive. He's going to call you 10 times a day. Well, that was nothing. 4 years later, when we drove the middle one, the spoiled one, Ovi, she really cried 12 hours. And then we got there Friday. I said, let's go back. She said, you can go back. I stay. Oh, come on. We need to go back. So I called the conference president. We stay 2 more days. Okay. We stayed Saturday and Sunday. Sunday, I said, let's go back home. She said, no, another day. Okay. We stayed Monday. Let's go back. She said, no, another day. I said, oh, come on. We need to go back. Well, well, well. She took Ovi in her arms and she would not let him go. And Ovi, mom, come on. Mom, enough, mom. I said, leave him. Let him be. Let's go home. She started to cry. She got in the van and 12 hours, she didn't talk to me like I have done something wrong. I said, honey, you have me. She said, not the same. I said, you can go once a month and spend the weekend. I don't have a problem with that. Can I move there? No. Do you follow me? Do you think that it was easy for her to give up her 6-year-old single baby? Do you think it was easy? Oh. Not just to give him up. She didn't have Facebook. She didn't have cell phone. She didn't have mail. And she would go only once a year to see him. Moreover, he was not safe. He was in the house of Eli, where Hophni and Phinehas, those two sons, were evil and corrupted. You remember? Would you leave your baby there? Why did she do it? Because she was a woman of prayer. And she knew the Lord, and she knew that the baby is safer than at home. Because she was praying. When we are not safe, you know why we are not safe? I'm not saying that accidents don't happen to Adventists. I'm saying when we have no peace. You follow me? She was praying, and when she gave up the baby, she didn't pray, Lord, hey, let's get right there. She didn't say, Lord, be with me. Give me strength. Give me power. I cannot stand it. I have to give up my son. Be with him and protect him from this evil pastor and these sons. 10 Bible verses long prayer. 10 verses prayer. Nothing negative. All praises. She doesn't ask anything. Lord, be with me. Be with the baby. She says, I praise the Lord. My horn is exalted. I rejoice in the Lord. I rejoice in your salvation. 10 verses, if you read them, all praises. You give up your baby and you don't even pray for his protection and safety and for strength that you can bear it? People who pray, whatever they go through, they are able to sing and rejoice. What if we all prayed that type of prayer? It's never too late. Imagine how our homes would change. Imagine what inheritance you'll give to your children and grandchildren. Imagine how our churches would change. We cannot lose the privilege of prayer. There is no greater blessing. God wants to be with you. God badly wants to enter. He wants to answer our prayers. Let's pray. You cannot afford to lose that. That's not to lose. That's to rejoice and scream of joy. I mean, the God of the universe wants to enter my house. Amen. Now, how do we know that she prayed? She prayed before having a baby. She prayed when she was pregnant. She prayed when the baby was small. She prayed when she gave the baby to the temple. She prayed after. How do we know that she prayed? How do we know that she prayed? Well, they went home. She got pregnant. Listen. The baby stayed at the temple and was wearing an ephod. You know what is an ephod? It's a priestly garment. It's a big thing and has, I'm not going to describe it. I think you know how the priestly garment was. But then it says that his mother once a year would bring him a little robe. You know what people think? That she gave him a little priestly garment to put over the big priestly garment. You don't put a small garment over a big garment. It just doesn't work. And you don't change it once a year because it's going to stink. So what did she give him? So I looked in the Hebrew again because it's just powerful. For the word ephod that he was wearing is ephod, I mean the priestly garment. But for the little robe that we translate in English, little robe, is male, that in our dictionary, actual Hebrew, we say little cover. But if you go in that time and dig up the word, it was something different. The word male means, and if you look in archaeology, they had a custom. For little children, when they pray, they had a prayer shawl. Do you know what is a prayer shawl? This is a prayer shawl. It has gold fiber, really real gold, and they cover themselves when they pray. You follow me? For small children, they use one. For bigger children, sometime when they would give a gift, they would put them, sew them together, two. And for adults, sometime one or two or even three. And the more they had, the more prayers they thought they have. So this word is translated that she would sew together prayer shawls that he could cover himself with them. So in your opinion, what was the message when she gave him the prayer shawls? Son, I want you to know that you are covered in prayers from head to toes. Because I am praying for you in the morning, at noon, in the afternoon, in the evening, during the night, 24/7. When I'm driving, when I go home, I'm praying for you, and there is nothing you can do to stop me praying. That's what my dad did for me. What if we all do that? That's the way you pray for people. That's the way you pray for your spouse. That's the way you pray for your children. That's the way you pray for revival. Oh, Lord, give us your Holy Spirit. Amen. Do you really mean it? If you really mean it, that's the way you pray. That's what God calls the church to do. That's God's call to the church. Every day. How many days? Every day Samuel was the subject of her prayers. Every year she made with her own a robe, and then she says, listen, every fiber woven with prayer. That's a lot of prayers. And she didn't even pray that he gets in Loma Linda or he becomes a doctor or an engineer. This is what she prayed. She prayed not for the earthly values, but she prayed that he might attain the greatness which heaven values, that he might honor God and bless his fellow men. That's what she prayed for. She did not fix her eyes on these temporary things. She fixed her eyes on heaven and said, Lord, I gave him to you. I want him to serve you. I want him to be a blessing for others. Basically, when you give it all to God, I tell you, brother and sister, if you don't focus on self and focus on God, God will take care of you. And he does a better job to take care of you if you take care of you. I don't know if you follow me. You need to take care of God. And don't worry, he will take care of you. If you take care of you, it's going to be messy. It's better to put God first. Anyway, let's finish. I'm going to give you a story and we finish. And I think you know the story. Our time is up, so let's just... The sermon has 8 pages, and I'm only in page 1, so why go more? Stories. Jesus used stories. It's better to use stories than teachings. Listen, folks. You heard the story. I am positive you know the story, but it's just appropriate. It matches our subject. Jim Simbala, Brooklyn Tabernacle Church. You know the story already. His wife, Karen. His daughter, Chrissy. His daughter, Chrissy, left family, left church, would not want to go back to church. And they would talk to her, Chrissy, you need to go back. Jesus loves you. Dad, stop talking about Jesus. If you talk about Jesus again, I will never talk to you again. He would call again, Chrissy, we are praying for you. Please come home. Dad, if you one more time mention the word Jesus or prayer, I will never talk to you again. Next day, Chrissy, please come home. Let's go to church. Chrissy changed her telephone number, changed her Facebook account, changed her email, never talked to them, and they knew nothing about the girl. For 2 years, they didn't even know if Chrissy is alive or dead. And they prayed for her. Lord, be with Chrissy, please bring her back. And nothing happened. As we pray for our children, for our families, and nothing happens. And one Tuesday night, when they had prayer meeting at the church, they prayed like for a list of over 100 people. And Lord, be with Chrissy. And Lord, be with Jimmy. And Lord, be with... And one of the sisters says, Pastor, there's no prayer. What do you mean? When you pray for somebody, you labor. That's prayer. You grab the Lord and you don't let it go. That's the way you pray. I said, but we have a list of 100 children. I said, well, we've been praying for them for the last 6 months and nobody came back. Why don't we take 2 and labor until they come back and then take another 2? At least we get something. He says to the church, you okay with that? Yep. So they took Chrissy and the head elder's daughter and they started to pray at 7 p.m. And they prayed to 8, and they prayed to 9, and they prayed to 10 o'clock, and they prayed to 11, and the pastor says, hey, if you go to work tomorrow, feel free to quietly go home. The others, we continue to pray. And one of them says, how long, pastor? And the pastor said, until we get an answer. We'll not go home, we'll not sleep, we'll not eat, we die here until we get an answer. That's the way you pray. And they prayed and it was 12 midnight and they prayed and it was 1 a.m. And at 2 a.m. they felt a peace that could not be described. And they all started to praise the Lord. So they went home. Prayers changed, he says, into songs. Prayer changed into songs. And then they went home. He goes home and his wife says, what happened to you? I've been calling all night and your phone is off. Well, I was praying. Honey, why don't you let me know? I called the ambulance, I called the hospital, I called the police. He said, honey, I wish you were there. Chrissy is okay. How do you know? Did she call you? No, she didn't. Did she email you? No, she didn't. Then how do you know? Oh, if you are there. When God talks, you know. Even if you are deaf and blind and not very bright, you still know. And he can talk to a donkey, he can talk to a child. When he talks, you know. Honey, Chrissy is okay. And they went to sleep. Morning, he's in his bathroom, shaving. His wife comes running. Honey, calm down. Chrissy is here. She wants to talk to you. Calm down. He says, let me finish. No, come now. Honey, I just shaved the right side. I need to finish to shave the left. No, come. Okay. He cleans the foam, half shaved, half not shaved. He comes down. Chrissy is in the living room, on the floor, on the carpet, sobbing, breaking in tears. Chrissy, are you okay, honey? Dad, please forgive me. I've sinned against you. I've sinned against God. Please, I love you. He hugs her and they cry. And he says, what made you turn around? Dad, who has been praying for me last night? Oh, we have always been praying for you. No, I never felt it. Last night, at 2 a.m., I had a dream. I was falling off the cliff, off the mountain, into a valley and dying. And I said, Lord, I cannot save myself. I don't have the power. Would you save me? And she said, I saw God's hand reaching out and catching me and said, I love you. I got you. I will never let you go. I love you. Dad, who has been praying for me last night? That's the way you pray. If things don't happen, it's not that God changed. God never changes. It's because we don't pray. What if everybody would pray that type of prayer? God is calling the church today. Don't expect the church to pray. God is calling you. You are the church. Don't wait for the pastor. Don't wait for the elder. Whoever you are, God is calling you starting today, not tomorrow. Starting now. to start that type of life. Taste and see how good the Lord is. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, what a privilege. What a God. Thank you so much for the promise that whenever we come in your presence in Jesus' name, asking according to your will, you answer. Lord, yes, sometimes it may take longer than we think, or you may answer different. But if we know you, we know that that's the best. Please help us become people of prayer. And do whatever it takes. Don't let us go until we all pray like Jesus. Because we pray in Jesus' merits. And thank you for answering, Lord. We love you. Amen.
The shadows come. Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home when Jesus is I know He watches me. I sing because I'm happy. Oh, I sing because I am free. He's a on the sparrow, and I know He watches. Yes, I know He watches. I know He watches over.
We will have anointing service right now. Anointing is not only for the dying, but rather for the living. Anointing is not only for physical problems, but also for emotional problems, and also for dedication to service. When you invite the Holy Spirit to be with you as you decide to serve the Lord. We will have here a group of pastors or elders, I don't know exactly because I don't know them all. They will have oil. We invite those who want to be part of the anointing service to form maybe a line or two quietly. Take the time to pray in your mind and come in line and keep quiet. If you need to leave, quietly leave. And as you come, do not give us a story. We don't have time. There will be people waiting. Just give us one or two prayer requests. Do not give us 20 prayer requests. You heard what I said? One or two. Don't give us the story. God knows the story. If you start from Genesis and finish at Revelation with the story, it's going to take forever. Give us one or two prayer requests. The pastors are going to lay hands on you and pray for that one or two prayer requests, and then they will anoint you with oil. As soon as that happens, don't tuck around. Quietly leave and keep that prayer atmosphere. Is it clear? Let's do that. Those who want to be part of it, we invite you to form two lines. If the line is long, you can remain seated and join the line as people come and get anointed. Also, I invite the pastors who will be part of it to come here forward and form a few stations, and you don't go for somebody because people have no power to do miracles. It is only a symbol. You go to whatever station is available. You follow me? And as you come, we'll have stations here. We will pray for you. And then you go. I would like to ask the pastors who do the anointing to use only a little oil so we don't spill it over their clothing. And as soon as you do the anointing, have napkins and make sure that you clean them and you clean yourself so we don't spill the oil on their clothing. Thank you so much. Yes. We have stations all over. I would like, wherever I the stations, raise your hands. Do you see there stations in the back? In the middle, in the back. Would you look back? Do you see the stations there? In the left side, in the back. Do you see it there? We have stations all over. Go quietly to the stations. Oil is only a symbol. When you anoint, call the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit That's the miracle, not the oil. God bless you.